Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Day of Reckoning by William W. Johnstone and J.A. Johnstone. Narrated by P.J. Ochlan. Chapter 1. Archer, Wyoming Territory. The first rider came into town from the north, stopping in front of Mrs. Steinberg's boarding house. He tied his horse off at the hitching post, then went inside. He was a large man who had once been a prize fighter, and that occupation had left him with two distinguishing features. His nose had been broken, so that the bridge of it lay closer to his face than normal, and he had a cauliflower left ear. He signed his name Clay Callahan, with tobacco-stained fingers.
"Will you be staying with us for an extended period of time, Mr.?"
Bella Steinberg paused to read the name.
"Callahan? The reason I ask is anyone who stays longer than a month gets a special rate."
"No," Callahan replied. "Just for a few days."
"Oh, well, don't get me wrong. I am most happy to have you. But generally, people who stay less than a month take their lodging at the hotel."
Callahan smiled.
"I like the homey atmosphere of a boarding house," he said.
"Yes," Mrs. Steinberg replied. "All of our residents regard this as their home, and as you will see when you dine with us, it is as if we are one big family."
"That's exactly the way I like it."
Zeke Manning rode into town 2 days later, checking into the Adams Hotel. Manning and Callahan weren't in the same room at the same time until the next evening after Manning arrived. Manning went to the Cock of the Walk saloon, where Callahan, who had already been in town for 3 days, was joking and laughing with the new friends he had made. And though Callahan saw Manning come in, the two men maintained a separation. In a town as small as Archer, any new visitor was noticed, and several of the saloon patrons commented on getting two new people coming to town within just a few days. It created even more attention when two more strangers arrived later that same evening. The two men were laughing and talking loudly as they stepped up to the bar.
"Barkeep," one of them called. "A beer for me and my brother."
The bartender filled two mugs and set them before the brothers. One of the two turned away from the bar and looked out over the 10 tables, all of them occupied by from 1 to 4 men. A couple of bar girls were hopping from table to table.
"Hello to all here. My name is Dan LaFarge. This is my brother, Don. Anyone here from Texas?"
"Yeah, I'm from Texas,"
a rather large man said.
"I'm from Texas, too. What about it?" "We're from Texas, too. Barkeep, give our Texas friends a drink on me and my brother."
Dan and Don flirted outrageously with the bar girls and went from table to table, laughing and talking with the other saloon patrons. Archer was a railroad town, 5 miles east of Cheyenne, and it was here that the holding and feeding pens were located for shipping cattle. Earlier that day, Duff MacCallister, Elmer Gleason, and Wang Chow had brought cattle here to be shipped out.
"Here you go, Mr. MacCallister. A receipt for the rail shipment of 200 Black Angus cattle to the McCord Beef Processing Plant in Kansas City. Your beeves will be there in 2 days,
Bull Blackwell said. Blackwell was the shipping agent for the Union Pacific Railroad in Archer. He got the name Bull because he was a big man, with broad shoulders and a somewhat oversized head that seemed to sit directly on those shoulders, without benefit of a neck.
"Thank you, Bull," Duff replied.
"You know, Mr. MacCallister, you've become one of our largest cattle shippers. You are by far the largest shipper of Black Angus, and while I would have to examine all the documents to be certain, I can tell you without equivocation that you are in the top 5 for all of Wyoming."
"Aye, coming to Wyoming was a good thing for me," Duff replied. "And I can say, 'tis lucky I have been in introducing the Angus cattle to the American market.
luck hasn't had anything to do with it, the way I've heard it told,
Blackwell said.
You come to Wyoming and started raising all these black cows that many of the other ranchers teased you about.
Blackwell chuckled.
I'd be willing to bet a dollar to a cow turd that nobody is teasing you now.
Duff laughed.
Sure, and you meet a lot of people who are willing to bet a cow turd, do ye? And would be for telling me, Bull, what you would do with the cow turd once you won it.
Well, I don't really want a cow turd, you understand? It's just...
Blackwell stopped in mid-sentence when he saw the twinkle in Duff's eye.
You're funning me, aren't you? And here I didn't think you Scotsmen had a sense of humor.
Just thanking ye, I am, Bull, for handling the shipment for me. I'll see you next time I come this way.
You going back home today?
Blackwell asked.
Nay, I think I'll ride over to Cheyenne before I go back. Cheyenne is only 5 miles, and 'tis so infrequently that I am this close that I plan to stay for a day or two and enjoy all the benefits of a big city.
To anyone from one of the bigger cities back east, such as St. Louis, Chicago, Philadelphia, or New York, Duff's reference to Cheyenne as a big city might sound laughable. But compared to where Duff called home, Cheyenne was a metropolis. Home for Duff was Sky Meadow, a very large ranch that was located about 8 miles south of Chugwater. He did his banking there, he shopped there, he had very good friends there, most notably Biff Johnson, who owned Fiddler's Green. Biff Johnson was a retired Army First Sergeant who had served with General Custer. Indeed, Biff had made that last scout with Custer, though he was spared the ultimate disaster, because when Custer divided his regiment, Biff was with Captain Benteen. Biff's saloon, Fiddler's Green, got its name from an old cavalry legend. The legend claimed that any trooper who had ever heard the sound of boots and saddles would, when they die, go to a broad, inviting meadow, surrounded by shade trees and bounded by a sparkling brook. Then all the old cavalrymen there gathered would have all they wanted to eat and drink. They would enjoy the music of Gary Owen and the Girl I Left Behind Me, and sit around telling drunken war tales until the last day. Fiddler's Green wasn't just a saloon for men. It was more on the order of what the English called a pub, and thus was of the character that decent women did not have to feel out of place while visiting. One woman who was a patron of the saloon was Megan Parker. Megan owned a dress emporium in Chugwater, and she and Duff had what could be referred to as a special friendship. Megan was also Duff's business partner. She had been an early believer in his idea of introducing a new breed of cattle to the area and had loaned him money at a time when he needed it. Duff, long ago, had gathered the wherewithal to repay Megan, but she didn't want to be repaid. She preferred instead to be a part owner of the cattle, and the nature of their relationship was such that Duff found her interest and participation in his ranch to be agreeable enough that he made no effort to disentangle himself for her involvement. Though he didn't share the information with Bull Blackwell, one of the reasons Duff wanted to go to Cheyenne was because Megan would be there on a buying trip for her store. They had already planned their rendezvous. As Duff left the cattle holding lot, he had absolutely no idea of the drama that was occurring at this very moment just down the street in the Cattlemen's Bank and Trust of Archer. There, Callahan, Manning, and the two Lafarge brothers were about to play out the real reason they had come to Archer. For though the four men had arrived in town separately, that had been a subterfuge. They were about to come together to carry out the nefarious scheme they had planned 2 days earlier. It was Callahan who went into the bank first to break a $50 bill, requesting $5 and $1 bills. Counting out the money kept the teller preoccupied. Because of that, he paid no attention to Manning, who came into the bank shortly thereafter and stepped over to a table, where he began to fill out a bank draft. A moment later, the two Lafarge brothers stepped into the bank as well. It wasn't until then that the teller noticed, with some surprise, that there were so many people in the bank at the same time. But what was even more surprising than the number of customers was the fact that he didn't recognize any of them. And in his position as bank teller, he knew almost everyone in town. The two Lafarge brothers raised their guns.
"This is a holdup!" one of them shouted.
"Oh, I'll be damned," the teller said to Callahan. "I believe they intend to rob the bank."
"Oh, we not only intend to rob the bank, we are going to do it," Callahan said.
"You are a part of this?" the bank teller asked.
"We all four are,"
Manning said from the table where he had ostensibly been filling out a bank draft. Manning, like the two Lafarge brothers, was holding a pistol in his hand. Callahan handed the teller the pillowcase he had taken from his bed in the boarding house.
"Empty the cash drawer in the safe, and put the money in this if you would, please."
"Four strangers in the bank at the same time," the teller said. "I should have realized that something strange was going on."
"Shut up and empty the cash drawer and safe like I told you to,"
Callahan said, his tone of voice little more than a growl. Complying with the request, the teller filled the pillowcase with money.
"Get the money,"
Callahan ordered, and Manning took the money from the teller. Then, just as the four men turned to leave, a man and woman came in through the front door.
"Ernie, this is a wonderful day. The collection in church yesterday was the best we've had in a long time."
The man who called out was wearing a black suit and a low-crown black bowler hat.
"Run, Reverend Pyle, run! The bank is being robbed!" Ernie, the teller, shouted.
"What?"
the Reverend replied. He was unable to get another word out, because all four robbers began shooting at them. Both the good Reverend and his wife went down under a hail of bullets. The four men ran from the bank and leaped onto their horses, followed out the door by the teller.
"Bank robbery!" the teller shouted. "These men robbed the bank!"
Callahan and one of the Lafarge brothers turned to fire at the teller, and he went down with one bullet in his heart and one in his neck. Callahan was the mastermind of the robbery, and he had researched it quite thoroughly, including the fact that there was no city law in town, only a sheriff's deputy who didn't spend all his time here. What he did not know, and could not have possibly anticipated, was the fact that Duff MacCallister was in town. Duff was also, at that very moment, no more than one block away from the bank, and he had both heard the teller's shout and seen the teller shot down. The four men mounted their horses, then started galloping away from the bank. They were bearing down on Duff, who, in contrast to all the others in town who hurried to get out of the way, had stepped out into the street in front of them.
"Who is that crazy son of a bitch?"
Dan Lafarge shouted.
"Shoot him!"
Callahan ordered.
"Shoot him!"
All four of the bank robbers turned their guns toward the man who was standing like a statue in front of them. With bullets whizzing by him, Duff raised his pistol and fired. His first shot took one of the Lafarge brothers from the saddle.
"Dan!"
Don Lafarge shouted. Don Lafarge was taken down by the second shot.
"Hold it up! Hold it!"
Manning shouted, pulling his horse to a halt.
"Don't shoot! Don't shoot! Here's the money!"
Manning, who was carrying the money, threw the bag on the ground and put up his hands.
"Manning, you cowardly bastard!"
Callahan shouted. Callahan aimed at Duff, but when he saw Duff's pistol being pointed unerringly at him, he had second thoughts and threw his gun down as well. Now, with two of the robbers lying dead in the street and the other two still mounted but sitting still with their hands up, an enraged citizenry began to appear from the buildings where they had taken shelter.
"Two of them is still alive," someone said.
"They killed Reverend Pyle and his wife,"
another said.
"And don't forget Ernie, they killed him too,"
a third added.
"String him up,"
someone shouted.
"String the bastards up."
"I'll get a rope,"
another shouted. The shouts were interrupted by Deputy Wallace firing a pistol into the air.
"No," Deputy Wallace shouted.
"There's not going to be any lynching while I am here."
What do you mean while you were here? Where was you a while ago when the bank was being robbed? Where was you when we needed you?
I was having lunch, Wallace said.
Come on, Larry, one of the angry mob said. You heard what they done. They killed the preacher and his wife.
And they'll hang for it, Wallace replied. But I'm taking them to Cheyenne where they'll get a trial, and then we'll hang them all legal-like.
He looked over at the two men who were still holding their hands in the air.
And this way, they'll have plenty of time to think about it.
Chapter 2 Deputy Wallace had company for the 5-mile ride as he took the prisoners from Archer to Cheyenne. Duff was with him, and so were Elmer and Wang.
I tell you the truth, Duff. I don't know why you didn't shoot these two the way you did the Lafarge brothers,
Deputy Wallace said.
If you'd done that, these two men would be back at the undertaker's parlor with the other two.
The difference is, the other two men were trying to shoot me, Duff said.
Hell, the way I heard it told, all four of them were shooting at you.
Aye, but these two changed their mind and threw down their weapons. And I'm for thinking that it would nae be a good thing to shoot an unarmed man.
You mean the way these two sons of bitches shot down Reverend Pyle and his wife?
Wallace asked.
We didn't know they was unarmed, Manning said.
A man wearing preacher's garb and his wife standing right beside him and you didn't know he was unarmed?
Deputy Wallace asked.
Ha! Try that in court and see how far it'll get you.
What are we going to do, Callahan?
Manning asked, his voice on the edge of panic.
We're going to hang, I reckon,
Callahan replied.
That's the first thing you've said that's right,
Deputy Wallace said. News of what had happened in Archer had already reached Cheyenne, and more than 100 people lined up on both sides of the street, watching as the little parade of men rode down Central Avenue. Many of them followed the riders, so that by the time they dismounted in front of the sheriff's office, more than a dozen of the citizens of the town were there.
Is it true they killed Reverend Pyle? Someone shouted.
Yeah,
another answered.
Shot him and his wife down in cold blood, they did.
You two are going to hang, and I plan to be there to watch,
another shouted.
Hell, why wait? Let's hang the bastards now!
You gotta protect us, Manning said.
Why? Wallace asked.
Because you do! That's your job,
Manning said, his voice breaking with the terror he was feeling. By now, Sheriff Sharpies had come out of his office, accompanied by two more deputies.
Don't you worry any, the sheriff said. I'm not going to let anything happen to you two boys. If you're lynched, I won't have any hand in it. But if you're hung legal, I'm proud to say that I'm the one that'll march you two up those 13 steps to meet the hangman.
It's going to be a public hanging, ain't it, Sheriff?
Someone from the crowd asked.
Oh, yes, indeed, it will be public,
Sheriff Sharpies answered.
Then hell, that's as good as us doing it our own selves. I mean, if we get to watch it and all.
Sheriff, I think you need to know that it was Duff MacCallister that caught these two, and he's the one that killed the other two,
Wallace said.
Yes, I've already been told.
The sheriff smiled at Duff.
There was already a $250 reward on each of these men, even before they tried to rob that bank. Looks like you've got $1,000 coming.
Sheriff, if it's all the same to you, I'd like you to give that money to the orphanage.
That's damn decent of you, Duff. I know the orphanage will be most appreciative.
When Sheriff Sharpies took the two prisoners into the jail, Duff, Elmer, and Wang rode out to the railroad depot. Elmer and Wang had helped Duff deliver the cattle to the holding pens at Archer, and even had there not been prisoners to escort to Cheyenne, Duff, Elmer, and Wang would have come anyway. With a wave, Elmer and Wang started back toward Sky Meadow. Duff, who had arranged to meet Megan in town, decided that he wanted to be a bit cleaner and smell somewhat better for the rendezvous, so he stopped at Mac's barber shop for a haircut and bath.
Is that him?
Yeah, that's him. That's the son of a bitch that killed both my brothers.
Eric LaFarge and Ira York were standing just outside Nippy Jones Tavern, which was across the street from Max. Eric had been part of the planning of the bank robbery gone wrong in Archer. He had not gone into the bank with the others because his job was to stay back in town to see what sort of posse was put together, then to meet the others at a prearranged place and give them warning. But there was no prearranged place for them to meet, and there was no posse. One man, Duff MacCallister, had stopped the bank robbers before they even got out of town. And Eric LaFarge had stood helplessly by as he watched MacCallister shoot down both of his brothers. Blood was strong, and even Ira York felt the connection because he was a first cousin. And it was the blood connection that brought LaFarge and York to this place and this time.
"The son of a bitch just went into the barber shop," York said.
"Yeah, well, he won't come out alive," LaFarge said.
Drawing their guns and holding them down by their sides, LaFarge and York started across the street toward the barber's shop. Mac was just building up some lather when Duff happened to glance out the window. He saw the two men crossing the street with what could only be described as a purposeful stroll. He also saw that both men had drawn their pistols and were holding them down, tied against their legs.
"Mac, get out of here. Go into the back room," Duff said in a stern order.
"What?"
Mac replied, confused by the unusual demand.
"Just do what I say," Duff said, even louder. "There are two men coming in here, and there's going to be shooting."
Duff drew his own gun and was holding it under the apron. Mac didn't need any further persuasion.
"Oh, my,"
he said in a worried tone, as holding the lather cup in one hand and the brush in the other, he hurried into the back of the shop. The bell on the door tinkled as the two armed men pushed it open.
"You gentlemen might want to come back a little later," Duff said in a calm voice. "I'm afraid the barber had to step away."
"Yeah?"
one of the two men said.
"Good. That'll just make killing you easier."
"Oh? And why, may I ask, would you want to kill me?"
"My name is LaFarge,"
one of the two men said.
"Eric LaFarge."
"Oh, I see," Duff said. "And you were related to the two men I killed?"
"They was my brothers,"
LaFarge said.
"And do ye be a LaFarge as well?" Duff asked the second man.
"No, I'm Ira York, and Dan and Don was my cousins."
"Gentlemen, I'm sorry it came to the point where I had to kill them, but they had just robbed a bank and they were trying to kill me. I had nae choice. It was either them or me."
"Yeah, well, now it's down to you and us," LaFarge said.
He brought his pistol up and pointed it at Duff. York followed suit.
"Aye, so it would appear," Duff said. "And that being the case, I would advise the two of you to drop your guns now, before this goes any further."
"Ha! You would like that, wouldn't you?"
LaFarge said.
"Aye, I would like that. I plan to have a good dinner with a beautiful lady tonight. It always puts me off my feet a bit when I have to kill someone. I'd just as soon not have to kill the two of ye. But if I have to, I will."
"I would tell you to say your prayers," LaFarge said. "But you didn't give my brothers time to do even that, did you?"
"Their choice. Not mine," Duff replied.
"Now,"
LaFarge said, thumbing back the hammer on his peacemaker. York followed suit. Duff had cocked his pistol even before the two men came into the barber shop, so when he saw them pull the hammers on their pistols, he didn't hesitate. He pulled the trigger twice, the shots so close together that to anyone who may have heard them, they would think only one shot was fired. Both Eric LaFarge and Ira York went down with a look of surprise on their faces and a bullet in their hearts. Duff stepped out of the chair and examined both men. They were dead.
Mac, Duff called. You can come out now.
After explaining the situation to Sheriff Sharpies, with corroborating testimony from Mac the barber, the sheriff had the two bodies removed. Duff finished his shave and haircut, then topped it off with a bath. An hour later, he checked into the Mixon Hotel on Central.
Yes, sir,
the desk clerk said, greeting him with a practiced smile.
I'd like accommodations for the night, if such be available, Duff said.
Yes, sir, we can take care of that, the clerk said,
turning the book around to allow Duff to register.
I'm expecting a lady friend. If she should inquire, please tell her the number to my room, Duff said. I hope that will nae be a problem.
No problem at all, sir, the clerk said. Cheyenne's ladies of the evening are quite familiar with our hotel and need fear no harassment for the practice of their avocation.
Duff looked up from the registration book with a flash of anger in his steel blue eyes.
She is not a lady of the evening, he said,
coming down hard on the word not, and using the more Americanized negative instead of his more comfortable Scottish nay to emphasize his response.
Of course not, sir. And I beg your pardon for the inference, the desk clerk replied.
He took a key down from the marked board on the wall behind him.
Your room is 205, sir.
Very good.
Not long after Duff checked into his room, there was a light knock on his door.
Duff?
It was Megan Parker's voice. Duff opened the door and Megan stepped inside to an embrace and a kiss. After dinner that evening, Duff took Megan to the Cheyenne Theater to see Annie Mac Burline in a production of Oliver Twist. There was a reception after the play, and the theater director, James Anderson, introduced the star to Duff MacCallister.
I know you have heard of our Wild West, Anderson said to the actress. Mr. MacCallister here is a part of that Wild West. Why, it was just this morning that he broke up an attempted bank robbery in Archer, killing two of the perpetrators and capturing the other two. Then this afternoon, two other outlaws seeking revenge tried to kill him, but Mr. MacCallister bested them as well.
My,
Annie said, flashing a broad smile toward Duff.
I have certainly dealt with heroes on the stage, but I'm not sure I've ever encountered such a person in the flesh.
Sure, and 'tis not a word I would apply to myself, Duff said.
The accent. Scottish-born, are you?
Aye.
Then we share a kinship, for I am Irish-born.
We share a connection beyond that, Duff said. I met ye and your husband once before.
Megan, who had been standing at Duff's side from the time of the introduction, smiled and breathed a bit easier when she heard that the beautiful young actress had a husband.
We have met before?
Annie questioned.
Aye. 'Twas working backstage at the Rex Theater I was, for the production of The Highlander.
Ah, yes, The Highlander. It starred Andrew and Rosanna MacCallister, brother and sister, and two of the most skilled and famous actors in New York. Wait a minute. MacCallister? And would you be kin, Mr. MacCallister?
Aye, I would be, for 'tis my cousins they are.
Oh, how exciting. I'll be seeing them again next month. It will give me a great pleasure to tell them that I met their handsome cousin, and to pass on news of your heroic exploits.
The next morning, Duff and Megan rode back to Sky Meadow and Chugwater. Chugwater was some 60 miles north of Cheyenne, but Sky Meadow was only 30 miles, so Megan would spend the night at the ranch.
It will give me a great pleasure to tell them that I met their handsome cousin,
Megan said, mimicking the actress. However, the smile on her face gave evidence that she was teasing and not jealous or upset.
Here now, lass. And would you be for saying that I am nae handsome?
Duff replied, his smile as broad as Megan's.
You'll do,
Megan said.
Chapter 3. 1 week later, Duff returned to Cheyenne and was, at the moment, standing on the depot platform with his friends Elmer Gleason and Wang Chow. Elmer and Wang were both holding railway tickets to San Francisco. Their baggage had been previously brought to the depot by stagecoach and had already been checked through. When Wang first came to work for Duff, there had been times when travel by train had caused problems. No matter what class of ticket Wang bought, he was often relegated to the immigrant car. But over time, and with frequent train trips taken with Duff or Elmer, the Union Pacific Railroad informed Duff that they no longer had such stringent restrictions on travel for those Chinese passengers who could pay full fare.
"From what I've heard," Duff said, "there wouldn't even be a Union Pacific Railroad without all the work done by the Chinamen."
He looked at the two men.
"I want you to do me a favor and keep him out of trouble."
"Don't you worry none about Wang," Elmer replied. "I'll keep him on the straight and narrow path."
Duff laughed.
"Elmer, 'tisn't Wang I'm worried about. 'Tis Wang I'm asking to keep you out of trouble, old reprobate that ye be."
"The man who does wrong is a lonely man. The man who is virtuous is surrounded by friends," Wang said.
"There he goes again," Elmer said, "making one of them comments that I don't have no idea what he is a-saying."
Duff chuckled. "Think about it, Elmer. It'll come to you."
"Yeah, well, I think what he is saying is, nobody likes a bad man, but everybody likes a good man," Elmer said.
"Hey, see there, you do understand."
"Then why don't he say it like that?"
"Woo, woo, woo! Look at me, Mama. I'm a train,"
a little boy shouted, and he darted around the depot platform, moving his arms as if they were the long piston rods connected to the driver wheels.
"Woo, woo, woo!"
Before the railroad, the inhabitants of the far western settlements felt totally isolated from the rest of the world. But they didn't feel that way anymore because they had the telegraph system, which kept them in instantaneous contact with the huge metropolises of the east, and even with great cities of Europe and Asia. There were also the trains, which could traverse in a matter of days vast distances that but a few years previous had taken months to cover. The trains meant that produce from farms and ranches could go to markets all over America, while bringing the manufactured goods from factories of the East that could be enjoyed by settlers in the West. Because of what the railroad meant to the people in the far-flung settlements, the daily arrivals and departures of the trains, even in a town as large as Cheyenne, were cause for spontaneous celebrations. The depot platform filled with people who were neither departing nor meeting arriving passengers, but were merely meeting the trains. There was always a buzz of eager anticipation as the time drew near. And due to the miracle of the telegraph, they were able to keep abreast of the approaching trains, so that at any given time they knew whether the train was running a few minutes early, on time, or a few minutes late.
"She's right on time!"
someone shouted after the station master made an entry of the latest update on the schedule board.
"She'll be here in no more than 10 minutes.
A few minutes later, they heard the sound of a distant whistle, then the chugging of the engine.
"Here she comes!"
There was, of course, no need for the announcement. The approaching train was obvious to everyone now, not only by sound, but by sight, for the huge engine arriving from the east came chugging into the station, its bell clanging. Finally, it came to a halt with a squeal of brakes and a loud hiss of vented steam. After the arriving passengers had detrained, the conductor made a big show of examining his pocket watch.
"Board!"
he shouted.
"All right, Duff. If you think you can handle Sky Meadow without us, me and Wang will be on our way now,"
Elmer said.
"I'll do the best I can," Duff replied with a chuckle.
And with a final round of handshakes, Elmer and Wang boarded the train. Duff stood on the platform watching as the train pulled out of the station. Riding his horse, Sky, he then led the two horses that had been ridden by Elmer and Wang. Before starting back, he decided he would get something for Megan. He would have done it when he was here a week earlier, but she was with him for practically the entire time, and he wanted it to be a surprise. Stopping in front of a jewelry store, he tied off all three of the horses, then went in and began looking at the display. He saw a Scottish Celtic knot worked in gold and hanging from a gold chain. It would, he thought, be a perfect gift for Megan. "I'll take that," he said, pointing to the pendant.
"Oh, what a wonderful selection, yes indeed," the jeweler said, smiling at the prospect of selling the valuable piece.
With the little gold piece of jewelry tucked away safely in his pocket, Duff left the store.
"Paper, mister,"
a young boy said. He was standing on the corner, holding at least a dozen newspapers under his arm.
"Aye, lad. Sean and I would be happy to buy one."
"Thanks," the boy said.
Before starting back, Duff took the paper into the Rendezvous, a saloon that he often visited while in Cheyenne. Ordering a scotch, he found a table near the back of the room and began to read the paper. Trial date set for murderers and bank robbers. On Monday, the 8th, instant, Clay Callahan, Zeke Manning, and the Lafarge brothers robbed the bank in Archer. During the robbery, the well-respected and beloved minister of the gospel, the Reverend Nathan L. Pyle, and his wife, Anna Marie, happened into the bank to deposit the collection made in church on the day previous. Callahan, Manning, and the two Lafarge brothers turned their guns toward these two innocent disciples of God's holy word, energizing their pistols with deadly effect. The Reverend and Mrs. Pyle went down under a hail of bullets, perhaps dead before they even realized they were in danger. As the evil four were leaving the bank with money in hand, Ernest Jones, the teller, in an act of bravery that would cost him his life, stepped out behind them and gave the alarm that the bank was being robbed. The evil men then turned their attention toward him, shooting down the husband and father of two. But the evil men were soon to meet their match, for Duff MacCallister, a well-known rancher from Chugwater, stood in the road before them, as immovable as the Greeks at Thermopylae. In an exchange of gunfire, he killed Don and Dan Lafarge, and brought about the surrender of Clay Callahan and Zeke Manning. In a related story, as published last week, Duff MacCallister was accosted by Eric Lafarge and Ira York. Attempting to see revenge for the righteous shooting of their kinsmen, Lafarge and York were themselves killed. As that shooting was ruled justifiable homicide, there was no need for any further legal action. As to Clay Callahan and Zeke Manning, however, Judge Commodore Buttram has set the date for the trial on Monday next. The trial will be held here in Cheyenne, and it is widely expected that a public hanging will soon follow.
"Reading about yourself in the paper, are you, Mr. MacCallister?"
the bartender asked. He had left the bar and was running a towel across the table that was adjacent to the one where Duff was sitting.
"Hello, Mel," Duff said. "Aye, 'tis guilty I am, though I granted no interview, and I seek no such notoriety."
"No, I don't think that anyone believes such a thing either," Mel said. "But I know for a fact that the people of Archer are beholden to you for stopping the bank robbers when you did. When banks are robbed, it's the people of the town who are most hurt."
"'Tis sorry I am that three good citizens of the town lost their lives," Duff said.
"Yes, sir, well, you don't have to be worrying none about that. Callahan and Manning will pay for what they done when they get their necks stretched within the next week or so."
"Aye. I expect they will."
"Will you be here for the trial?"
Mel asked.
"I don't expect to be. I signed some statements as to my role. I'm hoping to avoid having to come back."
"Not even to watch the hanging?"
"I take nae pleasure from watching a man hang," Duff said. "I just came to town to see some of my friends off at the railroad depot and thought I'd stop in to have a drink to see me through the ride back home."
"Well, I, for one, am glad you did. You're always welcome here, anytime you're in town."
Chugwater, Wyoming Territory. Duff rode into town the next day after he returned to the ranch to present Megan with the gift he had bought for her.
"Oh, Duff, this is an absolutely beautiful piece of jewelry," Megan said, holding the gold pendant in her hand. "I know I'm supposed to say you shouldn't have, but I love it too much to say that."
"'Tis thinking I am, that 'twould look even prettier around the neck of a beautiful young lady. Now, if I could just find such a lass, why, we could hang this on her and see for ourselves."
"If you can find one."
"Aye," Duff replied with a broad, teasing smile. "If I can find one."
"Perhaps Miss Willina Piercy would serve such a purpose," Megan replied.
Willina Piercy was a matron lady in her late 40s who had the misfortune to possess a countenance that was often described as horse-faced. She was a stout woman who had a stubble of hair over her upper lip that was almost as heavy as a man's mustache.
"Och, woman, you can be cruel," Duff teased.
He hung the piece around her neck, then bent forward to kiss her.
"And now, lass, 'tis asking you I am, if you would accompany me for a dinner being given by my neighbors, Captain Culpepper and his wife."
"You're sure I would not be an unexpected guest?"
"'Twas their suggestion that I make the invitation," Duff replied.
"Oh?"
Duff smiled.
"After I put forward the idea," he said.
2 days later, Duff and Megan were the guests of Ed and Julie Culpepper, owners of the Twin Pine Ranch. Because Ed was a West Point graduate and had served for many years in the Army, he was universally referred to as Captain. Twin Pine was adjacent to Duff's own ranch, Sky Meadow, which meant that Ed and Julie Culpepper, along with their daughter, Ina Claire, were Duff's nearest neighbors.
"Both of my parents were Scottish," Julie Culpepper was telling Megan. "There were some who teased my mother for her brogue, but I think sometimes she just made it stand out even more in response to the teasing."
"Aye," Duff replied. "Sure, and 'tis an accent that sets you apart from the others. But I've nae wish to lose the tongue, for it seems to me that to do so would be to turn my back on all that I held dear."
"Please don't lose it," Julie said. "I love to hear you speak, for it puts me in mind of my mother."
Megan chuckled.
"I have to confess that I love to hear his brogue as well."
"Then why is it, lass, that so often you mock me for the tongue?"
Duff challenged, though the smile on his face ameliorated the words.
"Sure, and would ye be for telling us now that ye have nae heard that imitation be the sincerest form of flattery?"
Megan responded, mimicking Duff.
"Oh, how well you do that,"
Julie said, clapping her hands in delight.
"'Tis like my own mither ye sound."
"Lord save me, I've been invaded by Scotland," Ed said with a little laugh.
"Mr. MacCallister, did you bring your pipes?"
Ina Claire asked. Ina Claire was the 15, soon-to-be 16-year-old daughter of Ed and Julie Culpepper.
"Sure nae, and would I be for coming to visit without my pipes?" Duff asked.
"I've learned the drum to Scotland the Brave," Ina Claire said. "I want to play it with you."
"Why, 'tis proud I'd be to play the song with you," Duff replied. "But first you'll have to give me a moment or two to prepare. 'Twould be a sacrilege to be playing such a song without my kilts."
Duff disappeared into one of the other rooms of the house. When he reappeared a few minutes later, he was wearing kilts, complete with a ceremonial knife called the Skiandhu and the Victoria Cross, the highest honor that could be bestowed by the British Army. He was also carrying his bagpipes. 1 month shy of 16, Ina Claire was already a very pretty young lady, with hair the color of copper, blue eyes, high cheekbones, a small, well-formed nose, and full lips. She had a drum strapped around her shoulders, and she lifted the drumsticks just over the drum head and glanced toward Duff.
"All right, lass. Jump in when you think the time is right," Duff said.
He inflated the bag and then started to play. Ina Claire joined in immediately, the roll of her drums matching the keening sound of the pipes. For the next few minutes, The stirring tune of Scotland the Brave filled the house with music.
Ah, lass, you were wonderful on the drum, Duff said when they finished.
Thank you for playing the pipes with me, Ina Clare said.
No, lass, 'tis I who should be thanking you. 'Twas as if I were listening to the Black Watch pipes and drum corps.
I've made haggis, tatties, and neeps for our dinner tonight, Julie said. It's my mother's recipe. I hope it's to your liking.
Och, sure, and 'tis as if I've gone to heaven, Duff said.
Megan, Julie said during dinner, I've been admiring that beautiful pendant you were wearing. It's the Celtic knot, isn't it? Yes, it is, Megan said.
She took it off and handed it to Julie.
I know that the Scottish Heritage Day celebration will be coming up soon. Would you like to wear it for a few days? Duff was so generous to buy it for me, but I'm sure he wouldn't mind me sharing it with you in this way. You can give it back to me after the celebration is over.
Oh,
Julie said excitedly.
Are you sure you don't mind, Duff?
Who would I be to say that Megan can nae be generous, Duff said.
During dinner, Duff entertained the Culpepper family with tales of Scotland.
Oh, it sounds so wonderful, Ina Clare said. I would sure like to go there. Your pa has been promising to take me there ever since we've been married, Julie said. One of these days, I'm going to hold him to it.
Ed smiled.
How about this fall?
Papa, do you mean it?
Ina Clare asked excitedly.
Yes. As soon as I market this season's cattle, I think this would be a good time to go. I think you are old enough to enjoy it now.
Oh, Ed, thank you,
Julie said.
I was wanting to save it as a surprise for you, but with the music, our Scottish guest, and this fine meal you prepared, tonight seemed to be the perfect time to tell you about it, Ed replied. Sure, and 'tis wishing now that I was going with you, Duff said.
Chapter 4. After dinner, Duff answered dozens of questions about Scotland, then bid the Culpeppers good night before he and Megan left.
Megan, 'tis thinking I am that it being so late, 'twould probably be better for you to pass this night at Sky Meadow, Duff said.
Megan smiled.
If you want me to spend the night with you, Duff, all you have to do is ask. You don't need an excuse.
Duff chuckled.
All right, lass. 'Tis asking I am. Would you be for spending the night with this old Scotsman?
Why, I'd be happy to spend the night with you, Duff MacCallister. Wanton hussy that I am,
Megan replied with a laugh. It was mid-morning of the next day when Duff took Megan back to town, making the trip in a buckboard as he had some things he needed to pick up for the ranch.
I should have opened 2 hours ago, Megan said as they pulled to a stop in front of her dress shop.
Och, one of the joys of working for yourself is you never have to explain to the boss why you are late, Duff said.
That's true, isn't it?
Megan replied with a little laugh.
I also don't have to explain why a strange man is kissing me in front of the shop.
She leaned over to kiss him.
Strange man, am I? Duff said after the kiss. And would you be telling me, lass? 'Tis it your habit to be kissing strange men.
Yes, Megan replied with an enigmatic smile. That is, if I find them appealing enough.
She kissed Duff again. Then before he could react or even speak, she stepped down from the buckboard.
It has been a perfectly lovely interruption to my schedule, she said as she started for the front door of her shop.
After picking up the needed supplies, as Duff drove the buckboard back home, he spoke to the team of horses.
Sure now, and if I'm not the luckiest man in all of Christendom, to have such a fine lady as Megan. He said.
Hartville, Wyoming Territory. Dooley Cooper and Pogue Morris had just broken their last dollar to buy a beer. They were sitting at a table in the Hog Waller Saloon, drinking slowly to make the beer last.
We got to get us some money somewhere,
Morris said.
We're so broke now, I'm thinking about actual taking a job. And do what? Punch cows for $20 and found?
Cooper asked. Cooper had a large purple scar on his face that ran like a streak of lightning from the side of his left eye down across his cheek to hook under his mouth. That was the result of a knife fight that Cooper liked to say,
left me permanently scarred and left the other feller permanently dead. $20 looks awful good to me right now. What about $100?
Cooper asked.
I'm talking about $100 apiece. Where are we going to get $100 apiece? From the purser on the Lady Harley,
Cooper said.
The boat is anchored here right now and is supposed to go upriver to Fort Fetterman tomorrow, taking some supplies to the soldier boys up there. The boats always start out with $200 in cash. All we got to do is slip on board now while there ain't hardly nobody there paying any attention, then go into the purser's office and take the money.
What makes you think there ain't nobody on the boat paying no attention? Morris asked. Almost as soon as Morris asked the question, the squeal of one of the bar girls was answered by the loud laughter of a group of men. There were 9 men in the group, all of them wearing blue and white striped buttonless shirts and dark blue trousers. There was nothing of Western attire about their clothing. At least 2 of the men were also wearing jackets and billed caps. One of the men had 4 silver stripes around the cuffs, the other had 2. The remaining 7 men seemed to be subordinate to those 2. Cooper pointed toward them.
All them men is from the Lady Harley, and the ones that's wearing the jackets is the officers. There ain't normally never no more than 10 men on one of them boats, and since they's 9 of them here now, it's likely there ain't no more than 1 man that's been left on board. Right now would be the best time there is to go on board, take the money, then be gone.
Morris smiled.
Yeah, he said. Yeah, let's do it.
The Lady Harley lay bow first against the bank of the Platte River, connected by a 2-inch thick hawser that was attached to a forward stanchion on the boat, then wrapped around a wooden post that had been buried deep enough in the ground to be well secure. A lantern hung from a hook on the bow, and 2 more were at the stern. Besides those 3 dim lights, there was no other illumination other than the moon itself at this point on the river. There was no actual fire in the boiler furnace, though it was kept banked so the fire could be quickly rebuilt in the morning to make steam. Because of that, a tiny rope of smoke climbed up from the twin chimneys, and a little wisp of steam curled up from the relief pipe. Cooper and Morris stepped on board, then looked back along the deck. They saw no one.
The purser's office is in here,
Cooper said. Though Cooper had never been on board the Lady Harley, he did know riverboats, having worked as a deckhand on one until he was fired. The 2 men slipped into the purser's office and lit a lantern. Cooper began jerking open drawers until he found a small canvas bag. Opening the bag, he found $212.
What did I tell you?
Cooper asked with a broad grin.
Yeah, that's good. That's real good.
What are you doing back on board, Mr. Roland? I thought you were going to stay in town tonight and...
The sailor who was asking the question stopped as soon as he realized this wasn't the purser or anyone he knew.
Who are you? What are you...
That was as far as he got before Morris, who, because he had stepped behind the door and stayed out of sight, stepped up behind the sailor and stabbed him in the middle of the back. The sailor went down with a muffled groan.
Help me move him,
Cooper said.
We'll tie him on a log and set him adrift. The crew will think he ran off with the boat's money.
Cooper and Morris went back into town, where they bought themselves a late dinner before returning to the Hog Waller for more drinks and spent the night with a couple of the bar girls. The newspaper the next day carried the story. Deckhand steals purse from the Lady Harley. The Lady Harley, which was en route from North Platte, Nebraska to Fort Fetterman, had, as the riverboats often do, put in here at Hartville for rest and restocking of the boat's larder. Also, as often happens, the purser drew $200 on a draft drawn from the Platte River Transport Company. During the night, while all the crew but one had come to town, the remaining crewman, a deckhand by the name of Abner Keller, took advantage of being the only one on the boat and stole the money from the purser's office. Keller has since disappeared, no doubt to visit his criminal ways on some other innocent and unsuspecting person.
"Look here,"
Morris said, having read the story over the supper they were enjoying at Kirby's Cafe.
"You were right."
Cooper read the story and chuckled. He started to hand the paper back when another story caught his attention.
"Oh, damn,"
he said.
"What is it?"
Morris asked.
"Here's a story that was picked up from the Cheyenne newspaper. A couple of real good friends of ours is in bad trouble." "Who are you talking about?" "Clay Callahan and Zeke Manning."
Cooper showed Morris the article in the newspaper.
"We have to go get him out of jail,"
Cooper said.
"Why?" "Why? 'Cause I think they'd do the same thing for us if and we was to be in the same fix,"
Cooper replied.
"Yeah, but we ain't in the same fix." "We might be someday, and it would be good to have somebody like Callahan owing us."
"All right," Morris agreed.
"If you're a-wanting to do something like that, well, I'm willing to go along with you."
Twin Pine Ranch. Captain Culpepper was drawing a bucket of water from the well when he saw two riders approaching. Seeing riders out on the road was not that unusual, but these two had come through the gate and were coming up the approach to his house. He set the bucket on the edge of the well and waited until the two were close enough to engage in conversation.
"Howdy," he said. "What can I do for you?"
"We'd like to fill our canteens at your well, if you don't mind,"
one of the riders said. The rider had a prominent purple scar on his cheek. The other rider nodded toward a watering trough.
"Maybe water our horses?" he added.
"Sure. Climb down, help yourself to the water," Culpepper offered.
He extended his hand.
"I'm Captain Culpepper, and this is my place."
"Captain,"
one of the two men said. Culpepper chuckled.
"I'm sorry. In truth, I'm no longer a captain, but I was for quite a while, and many of my neighbors still refer to me in such a way."
"Well, Captain, I'm Dooley Cooper. This here is Pogue Morris,"
the taller of the two men said.
"Been traveling long?"
"Most of the day," Cooper said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.